Sometimes you need a control which does not exist in LabVIEW. So now there are three things you can do. You can hack your way through it by combining several different controls and doing some placement magic, which takes a fair amount of time and tweaking and results in a lot of code in a VI which should have been empty without this control. Or you can create an X control which has this functionality, but X controls are not the easiest to make. Or you could check if there is a .NET control which has the functionality you want. I'll leave some links in the description below so you can check out what is available. One particular control that comes to mind is a datagrid. In the datagrid you can have different controls in each column, like a string, image or combo box. .NET has this control for years now called the datagrid view, and it's pretty amazing what you can do with it. So to put this to practice, imagine you're working on a project and a customer wants a fancy looking table where he can select properties for specific rows, like in this image. Here are some animals listed with an icon and a combo box at the end where you can select the color. In this let you know, I'm going to recreate this control with the help of the .NET datagrid view. I've created a wrapper class to make it easier to use in your LabVIEW project. You can download the class from my GitHub, which is also in the description below. You're going to see me use a lot of quick drop to speed up the process. And one of the shortcuts I'm using most is the smart insert shortcut. When I select the class wire and the arrow wire and launch quick drop to search for a method from this particular class, I can drop it in between with Ctrl+Shift+I. First we're going to create a .NET container on the front panel. For the datagrid view it doesn't really matter if you choose the default or the NXG one. I'm inserting a .NET control by right clicking and selecting this option from the menu. Most controls are located in the system.windows.forms namespace, just as the datagrid which I'm selecting now. First I'm going to make the control the correct size. And you can see that the example image tells us that the control has a width of 500 pixels and a height of 396 pixels. We are now going to open the block diagram and make some code. Now let's take a look at the class I made. It has a lot of methods which you can use to configure your data grid. Before we can use the class, we have to call the create method and in the end we need to destroy it again. So I'm placing these VIs on the diagram. Let's wire them up, align them, and wire the .NET control to the input of the create VI. We are going to need a little bit more space, so I'm moving the destroy VI a little bit more to the right. In the design folder are some methods located to change the look and feel of the datagrid view. In the create VI is some code to hide the control to make initialization faster, so we have to use the show VI after we are done with that. So now I'm going to select both the reference wire and the arrow wire, open quick drop and search for the show VI to smart insert it. Let's insert in a while loop so we have control over the lifetime of the VI. Don't forget to add the stop button. As you can see in the picture, the data grid has three columns, an image column, a text column and a combo box column. To set up our data grid, we have to call the setup columns VI. In this VI you can specify the name of the column, the type of the column, the width of the column, and if the column is read-only. The first column is the image column, which I'm going to call icon. Let's extend the array so we can fill in the other two columns as well. The second one is called name and the last one is called color. The color column is of type combo. Let's fill in some width sizes so it looks more appealing. And we're going to make the middle column fill the space of the grid. Both the first and second column are in our case read-only. The last part of the setup is setting the values of the combo box, which can be done in the parameter array. Each value in that array is a combo box item. I'm filling in some of the colors to give an idea how it works. Now that we set up the columns, we can run the VI to check what it looks like. It doesn't look very appealing right now, but if we take a closer look at the image, we can see what is missing. It will probably look a lot better after changing the row height and the font. With the set row height VI, I'm setting the height of the rows to 42. This should be a good fit for the font size, which I'm going to set with the set font VI. With With this VI, I'm also setting the font family to Arial, with a size of 22. Because we're going to add some more code, let's reorganize everything and make a little bit more space. Before we can see how these visual changes look on our data grid, we have to add some items. For that, we have to use the addRow VI. And because we have multiple rows to add, we'll do everything within a for loop. The addRow VI is a special method because it needs an array of .NET objects. Each item in that array fills a column cell. In the for loop, we are going to iterate over a string array with each item representing an animal, just like in a reference image. In our project folder, we have a PNG image called star. We're going to use this as our icon in the first column. To get this image, we have to get the application directory constant and build a path with the star.png string. To convert this image to a .NET image, the class has a folder named convert, where the image you write to object VI is located. Now that we have converted the image to a .NET object, we can create the array to fill our row. The first item in the row is the image. We have to extend the build array to add the other two. With the to.NET object VI, we can convert most value objects to a .NET object. So we're going to convert the string like this and add it to the build array. For the last column, we need a default value, otherwise the combo box initial item will be empty. The first color in the combo box is brown, so we're going to convert the string brown to a .NET object. Let's merge the errors and after that we can run our code to see how it looks. Now let's clean up the code a bit and then we're ready to test. It's starting to look a lot like the reference image. There are some parts that I don't want to show in my data grid. For instance, only one cell is selected instead of a whole row. We have some headers which we don't have in the reference image, so we have to make some additional changes. I think it looks a lot better if we make the icon column a little bit smaller. And we have to remove the headers by using the setHeaderVisibility method. I want them disabled for both the columns and the rows. And I don't want to show a scroll bar because we don't have any other items to show. So let's make a little bit of room and add the setSelectionMode VI, where we set the mode to full row and where we disable the multi-select because we only want to select one row at a time. When we run it again, we see that the selection now works as we expect it to work. There's only one small issue. I can change the row size and I don't want my users to do that. To disable this, I'm going to add the setCanUserResize and this allows the user to resize the rows and the columns. And there you have it. A fully working, nice looking data grid with a combo box.